Dear family and friends of Bhansali, as I stand before you, I'm reminded of what brought Mr. Amit Bhansali to this point. He started his journey with extensive research in 2008 and applied to become a PhD student in 2012. He devoted so much of his time and energy to contribute to this work, and not just for his own ambition, but to share with the academic world and beyond. So today is a very unique momentum, celebrating the completion of Mr. Amit Bhansali's PhD. You have also received a booklet on the PhD work. May I kindly ask you to take it home as a souvenir and focus on the presentation of Mr. Bhansali. Mr. Amit Bhansali, the floor is yours.
Dear family, friends, colleagues, ladies and gentlemen, I would like to start today with a small brief introduction of my dissertation. But before that, I want to thank all of you from bottom of my heart for taking time to come here and support me. There are many of you who have traveled from far. Frankly, I really needed this support. Thanks again. I have been practicing the Jain religion since I was a kid. Over the last years, many times I have asked myself the question, how could I share my knowledge with the younger generation? This compelled me to go through the Jain religion in a very thorough way. I believed that writing an academic thesis would help me put my thoughts in a very structured way. After some investigation, I realized that few countries had any knowledge on Jain philosophy. The Netherlands, and more specially the Tilburg University, was one of the very few who had a specific interest in this philosophy. After a detailed interview with the rector, Professor Eilander, the university agreed to take me as a candidate for an academic thesis on the Jain philosophy. I found great support from my promoter, Professor Weissman, and my co-promoter, Professor Nakhtaran. During this academic journey, I visited many gurus, Maharasaibs, and took their opinion in order to fully understand the certain concepts from the Jain scriptures. I must admit that due to the enormous workload required and the required time commitment, there were moments I was tempted to quit. But luckily, I had immense support from my father and my wife, who kept me going. Finally, I wrote the whole thesis by hand in Gujarati. It was not typed in computer. And then translated into English. So my thesis is fully written in two languages. If I would not have understood Gujarati, Hindi, or the notion of Prakrit, I would not have been able to read or understand our ancient scriptures. Today is the day where everything finally comes together. Firstly, I bow down to my Guru Acharya Sri Virendra Muni Maharasaib. I am fortunate to have his blessings. I am also extremely thankful to my father, Sri Bhanuchandra Bhansali, and my wife, Rupa, who offered a daily moral support. I would like to thank my mother and the rest of the family for putting up with me. I know I can be very difficult sometimes, and that's an understatement. And I would like to thank the following people. Rajubhai Shah, who has been my pillar in research and guided me through each and every step. Manishbhai Modi, a true friend who helped me translate from Gujarati to English. Iris Vandravekan, for being a good companion and getting me enrolled in Tilburg. She has always traveled with me for every meeting in Tilburg. Didier Becker, who helped me putting together this thesis, the booklet, and the presentation. Jaitri Mehta, Ami Shah, Kanan Bakkai, Asa Gulecha, my daughter Riddhi, my niece Reshma, my daughter-in-law Channi, who helped in editing the English version both contextually and grammatically. And last but not the least, Ingrid Evers and Ketan Shah, who have been my great facilitator throughout the process. This is the full content of my thesis. It is this and this together is the full content of my thesis. Now I'll introduce to my introduction to my thesis. The title of my thesis is Samkit, Samyaktva, Samyak Darshan, which literally means absolute faith in the Jain doctrine or Jain religion. The academic thesis is divided into three sections. The section one, from faith to liberation. This is the explanation of Samkit based on Jain philosophy. It includes, among other points, how one can have faith, understand faith, maintain faith, lose faith, help others to attain faith, and many other topics on faith. The section two, it's a dialogical interlude. In this section, what I had done is I had interviewed 5 authoritative figures in 5 different religions and asked all of them the same 7 questions and wanted to put their answer here so people can compare and see, comparing to Jain principles, where do they stand. And those religions were Christianity, Islam, Hinduism, Judaism, and Buddhism. This was done to see how other religions perceive faith. And the section three is ideals and practices. This section highlights how to apply the Jain philosophy in day-to-day life. I will now try to give you a brief overview. What is dharma, religion? What is it? The term has been misunderstood for centuries. It is neither a creed nor a cult. It does not belong to just one person nor the group of a people. It does not teach to discriminate against a certain group of people based on their race, nationality, ethnicity, endogamous group, or faith. Dharma is the true nature of a person or an object. For example, the dharma of a water is to remain cool. The dharma of the fire is to remain hot. Same way, the dharma of the soul is to get liberated. Dharma is that mindset and code of conduct that uplifts, illuminates, purifies, and enlightens our soul. Dharma is a mean to achieve the ultimate goal, that is nirvana, moksha. What is Jain Dharma? The follower of Jinas are known as Jains. The religion they follow is known as Jain Dharma. The normative code of conduct followed by the Jinas in order to beautify life and to purify and enlighten the soul is known as Jain Dharma. The promulgator of the Jain Dharma is a Jina. It is derived from the root G. The word Jina means a victor. Jina is also known as Arihant, destroyer of all internal enemies. Internal enemies refer here as anger, arrogance, cunningness, and greed, which is krodh, man, maya, lobh. These obstacles impede the soul from reaching to its full potential and ultimately achieve liberation. What is the true nature of a soul? As we saw in the previous slide, the Jain philosophy is based on the soul attaining its full potential and reaching liberation from transmigration, that is a cycle of birth and rebirth, sansar. The soul is immutable, indestructible, eternal, and has endless attributes. It is sentient, conscious, and formless. The chief attribute of the soul are knowledge, which is jnana, and cognition, which is darshan. By nature, the soul is a knower and a seer. Eternal happiness resides inside it. Key points of Jain philosophy. It is a soul-based philosophy. All souls are equal and have the same attribute, irrespective of their current birth. The philosophy is about one soul achieving liberation from transmigration, samsara. The transmigration of a soul happens among the following four forms of life, which we call it gatis. It's heavenly being, humans, subhumans, and hellish being, which is Dev, Manushya, Tiryanch, and Narki. Due to the fact that all souls are transmigrating in these four forms of life, Jains are extremely conscious of not killing any form of life. Therefore, non-violence is the key pillar and principle of the religion. To exit this transmigration and achieve ultimate liberation, nirvana, is the goal of all Jains. This is the first picture. I have it in my thesis. It explains that for innumerable births, a soul is binded with extreme, intense attachment and aversion, which is, we call it in simple language, rag and dves. And due to that, it keeps on rotating among the four forms of life, which are shown over here. And it impedes the soul of Samkit, means it does not allow soul to achieve Samkit. When the soul is ready to destroy this intense attachment and aversion, rag and dves, it will move out of that and it will try to move differently on the route. Now, this is a spiritual battle between, on one side you have attachment and aversion as an enemy, and other side you have the power of soul. Sometimes attachment and aversion wins and power is subsided and soul goes back to that form and keeps on having transmigration. Sometimes the soul takes over and is ready to break this intense and fierce attachment and aversion. So that is the time that it would move out and move towards attaining samyaktva by breaking, which is shown here as an example, which is called granthi bhed. And that is the first time a soul achieves samyaktva, which is the right perception, the right view towards the world. And this is very important because this is the key to attaining moksha. The whole thing is explained in full detail in my thesis. Meaning of samyak jnan, samyak darshan, and samyak charitra. Samyak jnan, any knowledge taught by the jina, victor, which is used to walk on a path to attain liberation, that is called samyak jnan. Samyak darshan is total and complete faith in the teaching of the jina and the faith in the capacity of one soul to become jina himself. And samyak charitra, to practice conduct in line with the path of liberation shown by jina. Now I will try to explain in brief how the Jain panths are, the sects. Panths means sects. You have main division done between Digambar and Swetambar. The Digambar, while ascetic nudity has always been a distinctive identity of Jainism, the formal split between those who believe in nudity to be compulsory for liberation and those who believe that wearing clothes is no impediment to liberation came around in the 3rd century Christian era. Digambar holds that clothes are possessions and thus considered ownership, parigraha, hence the insistence on ascetic nudity. Swetambar, stream of Jainism whose monks clothe themselves in white. There are three panths within Swetambar. Murti Pujak, believe in Murti Pujan, idol worshipping in a temple. Sthanakvasi, believes in praying to monks who have renounced the world for the reason of liberation. And Therapanthi, it's an offshoot of Sthanakvasi. These are the photos representing each panth. Although there are many differences, the main difference between Digambar and Swetambar is the Digambar believe that the soul cannot attain liberation if born as a female, as it is impossible for a female ascetic to practice nudity. But the same soul going forward in another life for surely will achieve liberation. All the panths have their own interpretation of knowledge, which differs from one to another, which is jnana. They also differ in a way they conduct their kriya on a daily base, which is charitra. However, when it comes to faith, all Pants have the same approach and belief. They all believe in having unshakable faith in Dev, Aryan Bhagwan, in having unshakable faith in the monks, Guru, Nirgrant Guru, and having unshakable faith in the path, Dharma, shown by the Jina. But above all, in having unshakable faith in the power and attribute of one soul, and to believe that each soul has a potential to achieve liberation. How one can attain Nirvana, moksha? As per Jain doctrine, the soul is never free from karmic bondage. This is caused by one's belief, conduct, and attachment and aversion, which is rag and dvesh, one experiences in day-to-day life. Due to this, the soul remains endlessly bound in this sansar, transmigration. When one imbibes true knowledge, develops firm faith, and practices true conduct, the end result is liberation. Samyak jnana, samyak darsan, and samyak charitra. Every soul, irrespective of birth in any life form, has the potential to attain liberation, provided it attains enlightened perception, knowledge, and conduct. After transmigrating into innumerable births, one can only attain liberation in the form of human, manushya. This is the last of the painting on my thesis. This shows the complete upliftment of the soul from where you see the man swimming in the water is where the soul is in part of transmigrating happening among the four forms of life. And he is not aware of the true view or the true perception. And innumerable lives have been taken over there. Once the soul gets lightened by karmic bondage, it starts journey towards upward. And that is the steps it is showing that the soul is going up. It is representing the status of soul in every step. Lower the karmic, higher the step. And higher the karmic, lower the steps. So soul has to get cleared by the karmic bondage to attain the last stage, which is nirvana, moksha. And then the soul do not have to be part of birth and rebirth. It is also possible by reaching halfway or even little higher, a soul gets influx of karma due to their intentions, because Jain Dharma has a lot of karmic influx by mind, with the intention what you're thinking and what you're doing. And for the same reason, one can have that again and may fall back down. So again, his journey would start from down. So this is the complete stage, which we call it as a Chaudha Gunasthanak. That is the steps shown by for the stages of soul. This is the section two. The section two, as I said earlier, I had asked seven questions to five authoritative figures. And they had answered me those. They are in my thesis, but I have just taken for example here one question and one answer. The question is, does your religion believe in a soul? If so, what does the soul mean? Who created the soul? And finally, where does the soul come from? From Christian perspective, the soul exists and is created by the intervention of the God. The soul and body are two different entities, both having their own importance. There is a difference between soul and life. The former has spirituality, wherever the latter does not. That is why Christianity considers a difference between humans who have soul and animals and plants who have only life. From Islamic perspective, the belief is that there is an existence of a soul which is divine. God has created the soul. However, it should not be mistaken as part of him. There is no correlation between the soul and animals, the reason being that God do not judge animals. Animals and plants are created by God to serve humans, but it should not be used for pleasure, sports, or overconsumption. From Jewish perspective, all created beings have a life force, but only humans have a soul. The belief is that Adam was created by God by blowing a life force from the earth. The word Adam in Hebrew means earth, Adama. Every life form, even the lowest, has a godly life force that keeps it alive. Plants and animals receive as much life force as needed to remain alive. Only humans have free choice between right and wrong. Hindu perspective, the soul is eternal. No one has created the soul. No one can destroy it. When the body is destructed, the soul is not destructed, but transfers into another body. Buddhist perspective, Buddhist rejects the notion that a soul is independent, eternal, and has a substantial nature of its own. It believes in Kshanikvad, that is a doctrine of momentariness, which means a continuity or a series of arising and ceasing mental and physical complex that is propelled by karma. Any aspect of oneself, which one may consider self, can be seen and arising and passing away. In short, it means old parts of the soul gets destroyed and the new parts takes place. So it's a constant change happening in the soul. Now, if you have seen here and if you'll read the thesis, you'll see the first three are more based on Abrahamic religion. They are together because they all start from the Old Testament Torah. So their belief more or less is the same. The latter two, Jainism and Hinduism, are very closely connected because they both believe in 84 lakh jeeva and everything, more or less. Except the main difference between Hindu and Jainism is Hinduism believes the God do take birth again, which Jainism do not believe. This section will show how one can use Jain principle in daily life. We can arrange our life and organize in a much simpler way. Some examples are product integrity, environment and carbon footprint, human rights and diversity, community engagement, accountability, and so on. So this is how the three sections have been structured. I thank you very much again for your support and being here. If anybody has any questions, you can ask because we have still 10 minutes. Okay. Yes, that's because once you reach at, okay, what is the question? Okay, what happens is the soul's progress is shown over there by steps going up. At certain stage, it is possible the karma comes back in Uday, which are being pressed inside the soul. And once that happens, the soul is taken away from the right path and is again pushed back down. So again, it would start its journey from the bottom. Yes, so it may walk. So what is happening is it walking in parallel, sideways, and then it falls. So that is what it is showing. And the one where the karmas are completely cleaned, those souls do not have to go that side. It goes straight away up. So that's a different one system, because that is explained. One system is where the karmas are being embedded in the soul and you go up, and another is by cleaning. So the one which is embedded would come up at one time and then you have to go back. Are we? Yes, as per our doctrine, we are the creator and we are No, we are the creator and the result, both. By not creating extra karma, because what you have created in the past, that is what you are seeing now. If you don't want to see now, and you have a right jnana and right faith, You will not create new by not doing what you should not do. Yes. Yes, and that's why the right faith and the Samkit is extremely needed, because it has a lot of principles, even for our daily life, what you should and not do. It's not only about religion practice. It's even about living a life, because it will be part of my, I guess, question and answer, but it will be how you can live daily life with that. So we are a doer and Yes. You want? Yeah, please go ahead. No, better. It's okay. Yeah, I'm okay. Jain principle, you know, when the Lord Mahavira made this Sangha, it is based not only on monk and nun, means ascetic way of life. It is based on four pillars, which includes a layman and a laywoman, Sravak and Sravika. He has very clearly mentioned and written down the principles, how one can live in life, in worldly life, and not yet have the influx of karma, or at least the minimum one. And that is, because the importance in Jain Dharma is where your intention and your mind is. If your intentions are clean and they're away from world, and there is a saying in the Jain saying that you are living in the world, but world should not live in you. So if you follow that principle, then there'll be a very limited influx of karma. Problem with us is we do not believe, and then we get engrossed in the day-to-day world. And that is where the karma starts coming in a lot. Both karma. Yes. 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 Jain doctrine believes to be karma-less, to be liberated. With good karma, you can't get liberated. You still have to get born, but you will have the good possibility, good life, everything good. But still you'll have to get born. Only way you can get liberated is not having both the karmas. The reason we are taught to have good karmas done now, because we are not at a stage that we can become karmaless. And if you don't keep your intention in the good side, you'll be falling back on the bad side, which will be very bad. So first you try to come from good or bad to good, and then from good to complete clean. And that is why we have been taught every time to do punya, punya, punya. It's from a soup, you come to soup, and then you go to Suddha.
No, this is just for the knowledge of non-change mind in this heart.
Yeah.
You can only be a Jain if you're born in a Jain family, or if somebody that believes in Jainism and follows.
This was also my answer. I would say probably it's the only religion where there is no conversion. You are not born Jain. For a social matter, you can say, I'm born in a Jain family. Jain is very strictly a way of life. Either you are living Jain or you're not living Jain. It's simple as that. You don't have to convert. If you see any religion, there is a baptism, there is a janoi, there is every religion has a conversion. And then you can say, from that day onwards, I'm a Christian. That day onwards, I'm Islam. That way, Jain does not have that. You can practice Jain, staying anywhere, born in any family, and you are a Jain. As simple as that.
As you said, Jainism and Hinduism stay close to each other. What percentage approximately you can quote that they are both similar?
There are other philosophies which are different, because Hinduism believes in a boon giver, a dev or a god can correct your karma and can correct your life if he is happy on you. Jainism do not believe anybody can interfere in your life if you have already come with those karma. There is no way even a god cannot change what is destined for you. Only yourself you can change. And that's the biggest difference between Hinduism and Jainism. And that then starts making difference in other points, because then you're talking about gods getting reborn, yada yada dharmasya, what you have, that whenever there is a problem in the world, I will get reborn again. Jainism do not, there is no possibility. Once you are liberated, you are liberated. You reborn again. I think it's a very good question. I think it did help me to have, I had unshakable faith, but it made me permanent now. I may had some doubts and reasons which were cleared in this process. So it did help me. And I did read my thesis innumerable times. And every time I read, I find something inside which I would think upon and would help me still get more stronger on that. So it did help me a lot. Because there are a lot of canonical descriptions and scripts written over there and the meanings of that. And that would help everybody a lot if somebody is interested in reading.
Kindly request the gentlemen professors to take off their caps. I open this session with prayer. May the spirit of wisdom and mercy grow and blossom in all of us. Please be seated. Ladies and gentlemen, dear guests, I would like to welcome you all at the academic session on the occasion of the public defense of Mr. Bhansali. First, before we start our discussions and deliberations, I would like to introduce the members of the committee to you, the committee that has read the PhD manuscript. So you can see here on my left hand, Professor Sharma from Gujarat University. Then next to him, we see Professor McNamee from Tilburg University and the University of New Hampshire. Next to her, we see Professor Keynes, Antwerp Management School. And then we have, of course, also the members, the supervisor and the co-supervisor, sitting next to me, Professor Reisman, from Tilburg University, and on my left side, Dr. Nuchteren, also from Tilburg University. There's one member of the committee that unfortunately couldn't be here with us today because he had to be at a totally different occasion, a totally different meeting, a very important one for him. That's Professor Day from the Université Catholique de Louvain in Belgium. After having introduced the members of the committee to you, I would like to open this meeting with giving the floor to Dr. Sharma for his first question.
Thank you, the members on the dais. I would like to ask Mr. Bhansali, first of all, as to what made him choose this subject, Samkit, for his PhD thesis.
The floor is to the candidate.
Thanks for the question. Highly esteemed opponent. There are many reasons why I chose this subject. I would like to list them. One, the Jain principles. And today, in the modern world, the principles based that are in CSR, corporate social responsibility, human rights, animal rights, ethical, moral principles, they all are getting more and more important in today's world. And people have to follow that much more stricter than before. With my research, what I understand is people will be able to see that the roots of those principles are very much embedded in Jain philosophy thousands of years ago. And they could help taking more principles to make the way they run their business and they conduct with other people that they come across in a very proper way. That was one reason. Second reason is, as you have read my thesis, it's based on constructionist theory. What I wanted to do is put up the principles which are there in Jain philosophy, because I am a practitioner also, but I wanted to bring that to the table. So the reader can construct his or her own life in a way that can help them get better than what it is now. What I mean is there is one more view, one more way of how one can live daily life. It can be added to the world. There are many ways people live, but this is one more way I wanted to bring. The third is strictly a spiritual reason. People who want to follow spiritually what Jain Dharma is about getting liberation, about understanding soul, having faith in soul, then it's a complete explanation is there in this thesis. And they can do it on a spiritual ground. Putting all these things in my mind, I believe that this thesis would help world, either in spiritual world or in a day-to-day life world. Thanks.
You're satisfied with the answer? Thank you very much. Then the deliberation will be continued by Professor McNamee.
Dear candidate, first let me congratulate you on a very interesting dissertation. I learned a lot reading it. I loved the multiplicity in it in terms of very different pieces of work pulled together, the dialogues, the history of Jainism, etc., the business practice. So my first question for you is that you are building an argument in this manuscript that Jainism offers a method for ethical, sustainable business practice. And you have a section in the dissertation where you engage in a very interesting dialogue among five different religious orientations. So I'm wondering, do these other religious or spiritual orientations generate in your mind equally or comparable sorts of ethical, sustainable business practice? Or is there a way of evaluating among different religious orientations in terms of how they might propose ethical, sustainable business practice?
The floor is to the candidate.
Thank you. the reason I wrote the section two, which is a dialogue interlude, which gives explanation on five religions by their authoritative figure, was because I started first with Jain principles laid out on the floor for everyone. Then I thought, as I believe in Jainism, that I don't want to make it a dictatorial thesis. I wanted to make a democratic one. So I took other religions' opinion, and that's why it's a triangulation I did. I did not edit. It wasn't a score from 1 to 10, and then I wrote what I wanted to. It was more what they said, and I just mentioned it over there. So a reader can have a much more bigger ground that they can base themselves, because many times, if somebody is following some other faith, it is difficult to follow other principles unless you see the same principles in your own faith. So giving reader a chance and a possibility of choosing among those was my intention. And that's why I took those, and that's why I kept those questions much more in comparison, so they can do it with Jainism. And this was my intention.
May I follow? So I like your answer to that. It suggests that you're letting the reader do a lot of work in making a choice him or herself. But along these lines of ethical, sustainable business practice and your articulation of how Jainism helps to develop such, I'm wondering about a particular, if you think about the diamond industry and the politics that surround the diamond industry now, I imagine you must have a lot to offer from a Jainist perspective of how your perspective there could come to bear on and help out with some of these difficult political issues.
Yes. To tell you frankly, it's one of the only industry which still is based on 80 to 90% trust, which is one of the most important element of any religion, and especially Jain religion. We do work a lot with trust in diamond industry. And the principles that I can lay out and I can think of that I'm using in diamond industry are much more than I would be using it in any other industry. So yes, this has helped a lot of people, or it will help a lot of people, and it is helping me while writing this dissertation, comparing what was I doing right or what was am I doing wrong, and changing the way it should be changed, or it is possible to change. Point is, you can't have 100% principle-based business. You need to choose sometimes between principle and what is good for business, not amending the most important principles. So it's like choosing of the lesser of the evil. And we have to live with that.
Then the discussion will be continued by Professor Keynes.
Dear candidate, first of all, my congratulations with your study on Jainism. I think it's extensive, it's innovative, it's interesting, a very good account of a system of ethics. I'm not a specialist in systems of ethics, but I'm a specialist in organizations. I'm a student of organizations. And so the questions I will ask you will relate to organizations and their functioning. And of course, I'm very interested in reading this study because organizations are also governed by ethics to a large extent. Now, therefore, I have some questions about the consequences of your study for organizations, for the society of organizations. And what we see is that we're becoming a society of organizations. More and more of what we do is kind of ruled and governed by organizations and not so much by people, so to say, because for me, these are different things. And that's where my questions will come from. So my first question, the question I want to ask at this point is about growth. So the world, in the world of organizations, growth is a very important very important issue. It's a kind of a virtue really embedded, built into organizations. You can also almost not think of any organization who does not want to grow. In Jainism, I see growth is also a very important concept. I see all these very nice illustrations in your book. Many of them are letters. Yeah, so you go up. So there is growth towards something. It's very nice illustrated also in the quotes you use. Now, but recently in the role of organizations, we have some discussions about growth, and during the same time when I read your manuscript, when I was studying a manuscript, I read an article in The Economist, and there was a discussion between two very eminent thinkers. One thinker was very much in favor of growth, and the other was questioning growth as a basic principle of how we run our societies. Now, my question is, what actually is the, could you explain to me the concept of growth in Jainism, and could you link that to the concept of growth in the way we are discussing this at the moment in our societies? And I hope that this will produce some insights for all of us.
The floor is to the candidate.
Thanks. Jainism has approach on a growth, but that approach is strictly for soul. When the soul is uplifted, it is equal to a growth in what we call in a worldly life, in economic terms. Question is, a lot of time, a growth in the world and the growth of Jainism are not coinciding. They are actually on an opposite stream many times. Because the people who are running the world or the economy are driven by their mind only. And today, the fast and ever-changing world, mind takes the decision. And that decisions are, and many times even mind does not take it. People just go with the flow. Point is, there is a disconnection, or there can be a disconnection between mind and the other choice people have about making decision is their conscience, which is with the soul, which is connected with the soul. Jainism do not say that you don't grow. Jainism say you grow, but in a way that you do not hurt surrounding, you do not hurt around you, or you do not put others down. There are strict ways, and there is a possibility of growing. So there is a connection possible. Today in the world, if the way the economists are seeing and the people are growing and the companies are growing, we are seeing the result what the planet is becoming. And about the warming and about the way the world is going. So maybe in my mind there is a view or there is a way that they should look at it. People should look at it. Growth doesn't mean just add top numbers, but it means even sustain it where you are. That also is a growth. So it's a different approach. And I think so it is very much needed that people should think with both mind and conscience.
Thank you. Then the discussion will be continued by Dr. Nuchter.
Dear candidate, I think that I'm one of the few who has really read your manuscript from cover to cover several times. So, but that is why I will return to the manuscript and to the first part. It is about 350 pages of text. In some academic disciplines today, the question of replication is once again a burning issue. This means if someone else would have done the same research as you have done, or would repeat it, would the outcomes be the same? My question to you, as applied to these scriptures from which you choose, goes into the same direction. If someone else would have taken the same point of departure as you did, the wish to follow the concept of Samyaktva through the Jain textual traditions. Would he or she have come to the same outcomes? In other words, how did you choose the text passages you selected for elaboration and reference? And what considerations did you have to leave other text passages out?
The floor is to the candidate.
Thank you. As we all know, Jain religion is re-established by Lord Mahavira 2,500, 600 years ago. Since then, the main pillar or the main principle of the religion was the right perception and the right faith. And probably all religion has the same thing, faith being the most important point. Since then, till modern times now, various sects of Jainism, which are there, has created innumerable books, texts, scripts, manuscripts on faith. Because if somebody needs to understand Jainism for any reason, for commercial reason or even for spiritual reason, he has to understand what is the first principle of Jainism, which is faith, to have faith in Jainism. So during these 2,600 years, many great ascetics, philosophers, thinkers have written down a lot of things about the faiths from different sects. As far as I could see, I found them in a different place. It's not easy to find them, but I did find them whatever I could. And not forgetting, and God forgive me if I have forgotten anything, but not forgetting, I have taken most important points from all the sects to make one unified book. Till now, there are books available, but they are more on the subject, plus, again, emphasize on the sect that they belong to. There are, not that in my knowledge, I know a book which covers under one umbrella all of them. And that is what I tried to do here. It's like an explanation that there are pearls everywhere scattered, and I tried to put a string and make a strand out of that. And that's what I tried to do. Now, if somebody else would do it, he may have some interpretation which is differing to me. But when it comes to faith, I don't think so that it would come to the different result. It would come to the same result what is there, what I have mentioned, in a grander way.
You're satisfied?
Yes.
Okay.
Then we continue
the discussion, and I would like to give the floor to Professor Reisman to ask a question that was formulated by Professor Day from Louvain.
Thank you, Chairman. The question is somehow related to a question that my esteemed colleague, Professor McNamee, just raised before me. She asked if, comparing the different religions, you would have a preference for their contribution to sustainability for one or the other, and you answered actually the democratic principle. But when the point of diametry came to forward, you emphasized the trust issue. Now, the question that Professor Day, who besides a professor in developmental psychology is also a professor in religion, asked me is the following. I put it in my own words, because he has a whole list. You had triangulated your view on Jainism with five other religions, that's the correspondence. But instead of studying the entire religion, which would be almost impossible in this context, you took representatives, authoritative figures in the field, and took their response to your question as representing their view. Now, what he suggests is that it's not certain that their view is representative of the official standpoint of that religion, not explaining what the official standpoint then exactly would be. Is it at the Vatican or whatever? But what in your mind does that mean? That you spoke to authority figures, got their responses, and mixed their voice with their, what you call their democratic principle. What does that mean to you that you spoke with authority figures rather than with official comparative religion studies or anything like that? Could you please give your view on that?
The floor is to the candidate.
Thank you. See, the reason I went into this dialogue interlude, second section, was not bringing out what is right and wrong in each religion. I'm not an expert in that. Mm-hmm. I just simply wanted to bring out that people can see compared to what Jainism is. If they want to go through the extensive study of those religions, they may follow this authoritative figure or they may not. It's a free choice for every reader. I just wanted to see that what the most important thing that Jainism had, which is a soul and the faith, how do those religions perceive? There can be a difference. I did not look into that study because it wasn't, I don't think so, it was my idea or job to do that. I just wanted to bring a simple few questions answered. And that is what I did.
Yes.
And that is why it is what it is there. And I believe that that is suffice for people to have a comparatively looking into Jain and the other principles.
Well, just following up a little bit on the last question, because it's, in my view, it's related. My esteemed colleague Nøkteren said, well, if somebody else would do the study that you did, you investigated texts and sources and explained them in 350 pages with sources that sometimes were not available to other people at all. So when are you representative? If you were one of the interrogated people, if you were asked a question, tell me your view on Jainism, and you as Mr. Bhansali are taken as an authoritative figure, you would give an answer that is yours, but based on deep study of all the sources. Some of your respondents had the same position. I think that for the Catholic Church, it was even the cardinal responding. So imagine him being Mr. Bhansali, representing the study of the Bible, and saying, I'm certain that what I say is representative of the Church. Just like you would say, what I'm saying about Jainism is representative of Jainism. Is there a possibility at all to have a final answer? That is to say, here's the truth, and that's the truth. I speak in the name of some godlike knowledge that should be understood by everybody on earth, and what I say of it, that is what it is. Or is there something democratic in principle that we never can know the real truth? What I'm just following up what I think James Day might follow up. I may be wrong. I may not be representative of James Day's mind.
So,
what do you think of that? Is it possible at all to be an authoritative representative?
In Jainism, as you're talking about Jainism, right?
Well, in general, and especially in Jainism, because for you, Jainism.
Now, for coming back to Cardinal.
Yeah.
He is the same cardinal who elected the present pope, so I know what he's saying. I believe what he's saying is truth in his religion. Question is, coming back to Jainism, I think when it comes to knowledge, the sex, as I said, the knowledge can be differing. If somebody asks me, my knowledge and a Jain other sect's knowledge can have a different opinion. The same way, my way of conducting religion and somebody else's way can be different. But I believe if when a question is asked to me about the faith in Jainism and the faith in the religion, I think so the answer, whether they would ask me or any other authoritative in Jain religion, the answer would come the same thing.
Okay, well, I see what is on your mind on this issue. Thank you.
Thanks.
Thank you very much. So then we will start for a second round of questions, and I would like to first give the floor to Professor Sharma again.
Mr. Bhansali, what do you think? Is your contribution by preparing this thesis to the modern society and modern system of knowledge? What is your contribution?
Mike, please. Thank you. See, the knowledge which is coming down to us from our form maker, Lord Mahavir, it is constant. It is not changing. Point is, how do you represent that knowledge to different people at a different generations? What I did to do, I did is bring those principles in a such a simpler way, because I wanted next generation who are going to run the businesses also look at it from that perspective also, and not only on a religion and ritual perspective. So the same knowledge, to give a different approach without changing the essence of that, is what I believe is my contribution to this this thesis. I can make mistakes, yes, possible, but I believe that on overall, it is going to give a lot of impact to new people, the way they think on the religion.
Do you think simply by having right faith, one can develop his spirit, that is his soul, as well as his society, as well as his economic condition?
Jainism, as you know, believes in karmic theory. Having a right faith is a first step. It does not mean automatically overnight you become rich or you become painless or you become normal. It's not possible, because that is due to the old past karmic bondage that you have done. Having a right faith as per the Jain doctrine would help your soul go into the right direction. And as Jain believes in reincarnation, it would go either in this life or the next or the next or the next, till the main aim of soul, which to get liberated, is achieved. And that is the main purpose for people who wants to follow spiritually this religion should do, to look at the right faith and just hang on to that.
How is it helpful in, am I allowed? Yeah. How is it helpful in developing the business?
It is helpful because your business requires, as I said earlier on, also a lot of principles which are today become like a compulsory. Like in CSR, in my section 3, I have shown with great examples how the right faith or right feeling, let's say you call it, or a moral feeling, would help business by helping who touches you on a day-to-day basis, or who touches your factories, or who touches around you, how you can improve their life instead of making a big statement. And that you can do it with taking this principle one at a time and embedding in the business practices. So it is possible, because it's not difficult principles. It's based a lot on moral principles. So you can help your business by doing that. Other thing is, what is important is it will help you what not to do also. There is a not to do checklist also that you should be there in, it is there in the thesis. So in the business, what you should not do is also can be gained from this thesis.
Thank you very much. Then I would like to invite Professor McNamee for her next question.
Thank you. Dear candidate, you said in some of your opening comments that this work was also grounded very much in a social constructionist perspective. So I'm wondering if you could address that. I have two thoughts in mind here. One is that one of the key notions of social construction is this celebration of multiplicity, a multiplicity of perspectives, a multiplicity of beliefs and values and ways of being in the world. So how do you see that aspect of social construction reconciling with your selection of, you know, a particular orientation, the Jainist way of practice, and to translate that orientation into business practice? And another way to ask the question, it's a little bit different, and you could answer both or choose one, is to say, to ask, what is social constructionist about Jainism? They're a little different, the two questions.
It's not that there is a social construction in the Jainism, because if any religion has to be followed, normally it is followed with the strict rules. You do this, you do this, you do this, and then you are religious or you are not. And I guess it's correct for most of the religions. What I meant by social constructionist is to bring those to-do list or to-do principles and put it on the ground, and reader, after understanding it, create their own life with those principles. That's what I wanted to do. I didn't want, for sake, say, to turn everyone in Jain religion. That was not my intention. Yes, it would be very nice, people who would like to, because it's a very nice religion. But people can choose their own way. What I wanted to do is, at least the principles which are linked with today's society, which are moral based, they can be helpful over here. That was one of my reasons. Because I'll give you a good example. May I continue? Yeah. I'll give you a good example. Child labor in a Western world has been very clearly defined. What is a child labor? What you should not do, what you should do. My point is, the maker of those rules, have they been traveling to third world or developing countries where there is no social structures? Have they seen what is the condition? And there is a question I always ask is, a young boy with a 14-year-old, a widow mother and a two siblings, small, he comes to my door and asks for a job. Am I to follow the principle of child labor, or am I to give him a soft job? What is the dilemma I would be facing with? And what do I do at that time? Should I let his family go hungry? There is no social structure. There is no government money coming to them. What would they do? So question is, the Jain principle will help me that whatever happens, laws or no laws, I cannot let a life go hungry or not help them at any stage. I would give them a soft job, let's say, or with a promise that you study in the evening or something. But I would not let their family go just like that because I have to follow strict corporate laws. So these kind of things can be seen from these principles, because these principles finally will bring you close to each and every soul which are there in the world. And that's what from my view, I'm trying to do.
Can I follow?
You think both your questions are answered?
I'd like to follow up just quickly, if I may. I think that you started by saying you were not trying to make the argument that Jainism is social constructionist.
I'm sorry.
But I think you just did make that argument.
It depends, because I may take it strictly. What I meant to say is not everybody needs to take it strictly. They can decide if they don't want to do it. Question is, at that time, their moral and ethic paths will come in. So automatically, because Jainism is full covering all those aspects, so at any time you will touch Jainism when you are doing any conscious decisions. There is no doubt about it. And that is what I believe, and I've seen it in practice. And that's why I could say, because my third section is about practices.
Yeah. But I would just offer to you that this notion of being sensitive to different contexts, like your example of child labor, is a really good example of understanding the multiplicity and complexity rather than just applying a law or a rule, and that is that relational sensibility that is constructionist and Jainist all in one. So just a thought for you.
Okay, thanks.
Thank you very much. I heard the audience agree, so. The next question will be formulated by Professor Keynes.
Dear candidate, I'm also trying to run a kind of a business school, and so my question is related to that. In business schools these days, you see more and more courses entering, which I think is very positive. Political scientists, philosophers, ethics, all these kind of courses are entering the curriculum, which I think is very positive. Now my question to you, if I would offer you a job, and this is a job interview if you like it or not, and if you like the job or not, if I would offer you a job and I would ask you to teach to business school students, or let's take the example of the MBA, what would you actually teach them, and how would you do that? Would you like to have a course? Would you like to see them in a different way? How could you bring the knowledge, your knowledge on Jainism, ethical systems, and link that to my business, so to say? Have you any idea how you could do that?
So teach them what, Jainism, or teach them MBA, other, what to teach?
You teach a course on ethics, so to say, to MBA students. How would you?
I would teach them with, I think so they are going to have difficulty in running big corporations in the world where sometimes the conscious thinking is put aside, and what is forcing or driving them is only the profits and the growth. I would teach them that they will come, and that crossroad will come in front of them whenever they are out in the world looking for a job, or they've gone successful and become a CEO of a multinational. At that time, I will tell them, go back to where you started and think what you want to do on that crossroad. You want to give a guilt in you for the rest of the life, or you want to have a harmony between your mind and soul. Based on that, you make a decision, and you won't regret it for the rest of the life. An impulse decision will always be with the mind and will never give you satisfaction. What will give you satisfaction, you start changing the rules then, and just to clear your conscience. But that will not bring you anywhere, because that will bring you more and more spirally downwards. So try to bring both things in harmony, that is soul and mind. We always talk about mind and body. Actually, mind and body is one same thing. You should be talking about mind and soul. And that is where I would teach them that make correct decision based on that. I'm not saying do not run your company, but make a correct decision when it comes to a very critical moment and you have to make a decision. That's how I would teach.
Follow up a little bit? So, but then you also have to tell them that they will work in organizations, and organizations are, they don't have a conscience, these organizations. Actually, organizations, we as students of organizations, we say organizations have been invented to have system without conscience, because otherwise our life would be very difficult. And so what, and if they say, yeah, but my organization or my CEO, my boss tells me to do this or that, how can they deal with these tensions?
You can't. And also the option is that you can't not work in those organizations, because it's an open world. You cannot just reject a job based on that. Point is not about not doing it. Point is about knowing that something is wrong. That is most important. And that people should keep in mind. People have two ways of looking a problem solving. One is they solve the problem and they say, oh, this principle is wrong, and the way I solved it is the correct one. The second one is you still solve the problem, but keep in mind what I did was wrong, And if I had a chance, or if I would return, or if there is a possibility, I will undo that. And that's what Jainism teaches. It's not always solving in your hand. It is about always keeping in mind what was right and wrong, and then undo if you can. If not, fine, it's not in your hand. And that is the most important thing. Jainism is not about working hand in hand with right faith and then doing a right conduct. Right conduct will come, follow. But at least don't lose your principles or faith.
Okay, thank you. I would like to invite Professor Reisman to ask a probably final question.
I'm afraid so, but given the time, it's amazing that the question that Professor Day wanted me to ask for him is very close to the one that Professor Keynes just raised, but has a different accent, and therefore I ask permission to ask it. He also says, well, what are the main things we should take away for instruction application like training or fostering integration of spirituality in the workplace? And the difference with the preceding question is he focuses here on the workplace itself, not on teaching a course in a business school, where the students are executives from other companies. Here, he seems to orient his question to training and fostering integration at the workplace. So your own company, for example, is there anything in your work that you would like to give us that we should take away about what your perspective is on training people in the workplace, your own employees, your own people you work with in the board, in the workplace, things like that. But I'm afraid.
Ora est.
The session is adjourned for deliberation. I would like you to stay here and wait for the return of the committee. Thank you. Dear candidate, the doctorate board of the university has taken note of your dissertation. Having heard your defense, the doctorate board has decided to confer on you the degree of doctor. Your supervisor, Professor Reisman, is authorized to invest you with this dignity.
It gives me great pleasure to accept the task assigned to me by the Rector Magnificus of the University. By virtue of the authority granted to us by the law and by the regulations of the university, in accordance with a decision by the Doctorate Board of Tilburg University, I hereby promote you, Amit Banuchandra Bhansali, to doctor and bestow upon you all the rights that by law or custom are or will be attached to the doctorate. As proof of this, I hand you the certificate signed by the Rector Magnificus and the supervisors and reaffirmed by the seal of the university. Please.
I perform a pleasant task, very learned sir, in congratulating you also on behalf of the doctorate board of the university on the dignity acquired. Congratulations. Please be seated. Your supervisor has just referred to the rights attached to the doctorate. Apart from rights, the doctorate title also comes with obligations. There are first of all the execution of research and all other scholarly activities with the utmost integrity, but they also include a duty to society, which needs to be able to rely on the sound and independent judgment of those holding a doctorate. I now would like to give the floor to the supervisor and the co-supervisor, who will give a, let's say, two-sided appraisal. First, I'll give the floor to Dr. Reisman.
Two-sided does not mean critique and praise, but that we will be both take the floor. Well, let me first of all, young Dr. Bhansali, dear Mr. Amit, because that's a ritual address, take this opportunity to congratulate you again loud and clear so that everybody can hear, and include in my congratulations, I don't think you are all family, but in any case, your family and friends, and especially your parents that I meet here, mother, and your, of course your wife and children as intimate members of your family. Please, congratulations to you too, and to all of you, because it's also a celebration day for you too, I guess. I have to admit that I have never seen such a representation of Indian culture in this environment. I'm glad to see a few local people, including my wife. Well, it's a wonderful event today. It's the result of a long journey. I remember you writing in Sanskrit, or in what language was it? By pencil, and showing this to us as your progress. Painstakingly precise and impossible to follow for us, but until it was translated and finally appearing in this great text of 350 pages, explanation of Jainism with never-seen resources, that my esteemed colleague said it's virtually impossible to read from cover to cover. I have to admit, I tried to read it from cover to cover, but I could not follow every step in the first thing, so reading is an ambiguous term, and you have to live with it. But it was for me an absolute unique experience, I have to say that, and one I cherish a lot. I have rarely seen such an authentic figure with such a deep knowledge of a certain domain, and also with a unique combination of knowing something in text, like Jainism, and at the same time live it out in a very convincing and persuasive way. And that was for me the basic argumentation or basic motivation actually to help to supervise this and bring it to a good end. Because in the social sciences, in the academia, of course we are able to play the scholarly worldly game. But it's very rare that the word game, it's not Wittgensteinian that I mean it, but it is supported by real substantial understanding and authoritative representation in doing it. Now, in your case, this combination was totally represented. And I have learned to know you as an individual, as a human being, and I have to admit that your authenticity, your clear knowledge of the Jainist religion, and also the authenticity and mastery of doing business according to these principles, doing your very best knowing that it never is perfect, but that you have to adapt it in many ways and to show it as an example to other people who can learn from it, this was for me the absolute motivation to help you to bring this to a good end. Because if we need books in the library of people who want to study a profession like economics or management or whatever, and we want to show them well-documented books founded and originating from the real world, I would advise to read your book. And that for me is the simple argumentation to support this. this fits into a development of the social sciences. And let me say something that just came up when I was listening to the deliberation. This university was actually founded on a basis of that principle. You may not know it, but 85 years ago, the reason to found this university was because some people in this area believed that managers should be educated with a philosophical and religious basis of inspiration. And for that reason, they founded this school, the Copenhagen School called, and it's in this building, Copenhagen building, that we are now standing. You do not represent the Catholic religion, but the Jainist religion, but in a democratic way, as you said. So we are very close to home by listening to your story. And for that reason, I said, I liked so much, and it was a privilege and a blessing to be able to help you to this beautiful end. May I now give the word to your other supervisor, Professor Tini.
Is it all right when I sit? Because then the microphone will work better. Dear Dr. Bhansali, I'm happy and proud to be one of the first to call you so. It was not an easy trajectory, nor was it self-evident that you would one day stand in the university hall and be congratulated with this title. Those in close daily association with you know better than we do what it cost you in your position to produce this work. But there are only a few here who have an idea how much persistence, thoroughness, patience, and zeal it takes to study ancient texts. Yes, texts in plural. You did not choose to study a single text, either in part or in entirety, which may have been much easier. Instead, by following the trail of Samyaktva, you chose to browse through many, many, many texts. This had to be organized, navigating as you do between Gujarat and Antwerp. It also had to be organized with your close associates. Can we disturb him today? Does he get enough sleep? Isn't the business going down while the boss is writing his thesis? You were determined to do this. You are not trained as a scholar, and in spite of your long sojourn in Belgium, your initial approach was not in line with Western academic attitudes. In the process of supervision, you needed adjustment, and so did we. Professor Reisman has a talent for scouting special cases. In the later part of his career, he has become a magnet for special cases. And you certainly were a special case. But even John Reisman, at times, must acknowledge that there are limits to his expertise, and that is how he found me. I was interested, but apprehensive. At that point, your manuscript was growing, but we had no idea the direction it was meant to take. Could such a massive collection of text passages be an academic dissertation? It needed head and tail. It needed a research question, a method, an aim. I recognized what you were doing. Your long hours of toiling over Prakrit and Sanskrit texts seemed to be an aim in itself. Disclosing the concept of Samyaktva from scattered scriptures appeared to be driven by a higher aim even. You saw yourself as an intermediary, an instrument for amassing proper knowledge. But knowledge needs to be communicated. It needs a setting. It needs a contrast, a contestation, a discussion. And this is how you too acknowledged that something more was required. Although your heart clearly was with the ancient religious texts, we all collaborated to produce a creative tension, a counterpoint, an added value. Through dialogues and interviews, we placed the reflective mirror between textual prescriptions and the work floor, between lofty ideals and business practice, between ancient traditions and contemporary challenges. Of corporate social responsibility and accountability. The end result may well be called unique, and I hope that it may be benefit for both the Jain community as well as the community of scholars and businessmen. In Dutch, well, it isn't really Dutch, but derived from Greek, we call the two persons standing at your side during the candidate's defense of his or her thesis, paranymphs. They may assist you, for instance, when you drop your pen, have a blackout, or need a handkerchief. They are your right and left wings, so to speak, at least for this occasion. Typical of our supervision meetings, be they in Antwerp, Wilrijk, or Tilburg, you always came seconded by such paranymphs, your personal wings, either Iris or Ingrid, or both. And when I congratulate you, Mr. Bhansali, with your new title, I congratulate them too. They have been wonderfully supportive throughout. Both ladies were completely new to the subject and to a dissertation process as well, but with their attitude, a mixture of loyalty and practicality, they have contributed considerably to its completion. In much of the same way, I congratulate your family. They have seen you disappear into your study for hours, for days, for months, for years. And when in India, on so-called holidays, they saw you disappear into libraries. You saw the company of scholars and sages. You collected manuscripts. You collected advice and inspiration. They may have been worried at times. I also congratulate your closest colleagues and employees. They may have their boss back, finally. The company, Rosy Blue, may be relieved, but should also be proud and happy that they work in a company that takes social responsibility seriously. After having made this round of felicitations, I gladly return to the author himself. From a very young age, I, myself, was drawn to India and made its ancient languages and cultures my field of study. From a very young age, you also were drawn, but in the opposite direction, to Antwerp, perhaps less by choice than by necessity. You took over what your father had started and became a businessman. But you clearly have another side as well. Just like a diamond deep in the earth is produced under immense heat and pressure, so your thesis came into being under immense pressure. When you had to make the title of your thesis definitive, I, as custom demands, made some suggestions for more academic-sounding titles. You did not reply or comply. And when you sent us the final manuscript, it typically summed it up concisely. Faith, practice, liberation. I now hope your life is blessed with those three in proper balance. It has been a privilege to work with you.
This brings us to the end of this academic session. You now can congratulate Dr. Bhansali and his wife during a reception which will take place in front of this auditorium. In view of the number of guests, I would advise you not to queue up immediately in a very long row, but first take a drink and take the opportunity to give your congratulations to the young doctor when the queue has become a bit smaller. Another thing is that I would like you to leave the auditorium after the cortege and do it row by row, starting with the first row of special guests and family. I now close this session. May I invite you to stand up, please? May our search be instilled with gratitude. May mercy be our guide. And may love go before us. The session is closed. Thank you.